All right. If you want to know more about optimal transport from a computational aspect, we've wrote a small book with Marco Cuturi. So you are more than welcome to go online to this web page where you can download the PDF, read it in details. Once again, I'm not going to give much more details, but well, it's supposed to be a reference book for all that is a computational aspect, in particular the algorithm that I will not describe but present to you now. All right. So just to motivate a bit and explain what is the question we tried to answer with this algorithm, it's basically optimal transport, which is in its modern form was introduced by Kantorowicz. So optimal transport is fairly old. It's a problem of Monge, of matching points or point clouds or density of mass. But the true revolution is from Kantorowicz in the 40s that describes its modern formulation, which is basically a convex optimization problem, a linear program. So conceptually, it's very simple. But of course, since it's going to be very large scale, well, it's become quite important to have an approximation and fast algorithm. So you want to transfer mass between two set of points or two set of masses, which in the discrete form would be basically points. So here, this would be the Xi, for instance, equipped with some positive mass, masses the Ai. Okay, so it's a distribution of mass. So the mass, they should be positive. And in classical optimal transport, and you can relax this after, but in its basic form, it has to be balanced. So the mass of the red point should be equal to the total mass of the blue points. Right. And usually it's normalized to one, so it's described a probability distribution if you want. Okay, and the idea of Kantorowicz, which was motivated by application in economics, but it's actually completely universal idea, is to relax the idea of matching points to the idea that you can split the mass by describing the optimal transport through a coupling, or also called a transport plan, which is basically a 2D array of number, which describes the flow of mass from the red to the blue. Okay? So each time you have a non-zero element in this array, it means you're going to transfer some amount of mass. Okay? So here, in this first line, you see that these guys get mapped to this point. So it's going to be like a deterministic movement of mass. But what is super interesting is you can also allow to split the mass, which is here the case, because this point is going to be split in two parts. Okay? And it's basically why Kantorowicz got the Nobel Prize in economics. It's because of this idea of being able to split the mass, split the production, to have more flexibility, to have a simpler problem. Okay? And why is it simpler? It's because the set of arrays that describe this movement of mass is simply the set of positive arrays which should satisfy the conservation of mass equation, which here is very simple because it's a linear constraint. It's just going to be that the sum of the mass along the lines is equal to the red, which means the red should be fully spanned. And also, of course, the sum of the column should be equal to the blue. So if you write this using matrices, it's going to be the equation P times the vector 1, so this computes the sum, equal to A, and P transpose times the vector 1 is equal to B. So you see, it's super simple, it's convex. And it's even more than convex, it's just what is called a polytope, described by inequalities and equalities. So it's probably the most simple set, but this is a fairly interesting set. It's called the polytope with marginal constraints, so it's very studied, and it gives rise to the optimal transport problem, where you ask yourself, we decide for some cost you have to pay when you send the mass, some unit amount of mass, and the most typical example is you pay a price which is just the distance to some power, so P is a parameter, so in Monge formulation it was P equal 1, most mathematicians would use P equal 2 because there's a lot of structure on this problem, but whatever, it could even be smaller than one if you like. And of course, you multiply this cost by the mass you transfer and you sum everything, and this is your cost, total cost. And the big advantage of this relaxed formulation of Kantorowicz is now this is just a linear function of P. So you minimize the linear function under polyhedral constraints. And it's actually the first introduction of a linear program. So Kantorowicz is really the one that promoted this idea that linear programming is the key to model economic behavior. And also now we use this more and more in machine learning, but initially it was for economic application. And I think what is very important is to realize that, okay, he got the Nobel Prize for this idea, but he also got the Nobel Prize because it's useful. And the reason why it's useful is because of simplex algorithm. It's because at the same time as Kantorowicz, there was also the introduction of the simplex algorithm by George Danzig, who created this revolution where linear programming is everywhere. So I would say until, I mean, probably a few years ago, this was the end of the story. Simplex algorithm was useful, was fast, It's basically have a cubic complexity, so everybody was using it and were happy. But of course, nowadays, with a gigantic amount of data you have in image processing, in medical imaging, in machine learning, in all these applications, you cannot use the simplex algorithm because it's just too slow. So the question is, how can you scale optimal transport to a lot of points, to high dimension, and probably maybe by doing some approximation? Because the big difference is nowadays in our field, data is really noisy, there is a lot of errors, you are in very high dimension, so it doesn't really make sense to have like a zero error or 10 to the minus 10. Actually, even a very crude approximation is more than enough for many applications. So it's really the typical scenario this library will be tackling is probably you care more about having fast algorithms than to have accurate algorithms, which is really the trend in most modern optimization, where people use less and less second-order methods and more like more simple, very old algorithms. Actually, the algorithms I will explain, they are like very, very old, like at least 50 or 60 years old. It's being like this reinvention or this reuse of old algorithms, because in our framework, it's really useful. All right? So just an overview of the basic algorithm and all the options you have. And I would say no one is better than the other. It's also something to realize. It's not like an algorithm that is better than all the other one. It really depends on the data you have and the accuracy you want. So depending on the regime you use, you might prefer one algorithm over another one. And the basic algorithm is just the simplex. And simplex is good for most applications where the number of points is like of the order of 1,000 or maybe 10,000. If you have 1,000 points, it's probably not really worth it to invest in a huge machinery or in advanced algorithm. If you have a single optimal transport problem to solve that is small, just use simplex. Also related to the simplex algorithm, but with a bit of a different dual flavor, there is algorithms that are dedicated to the case where the mass are uniform, so just points. In this case, if you have the same number of points, then it's a very important theorems of Birkhoff and von Neumann that the Kantorovich problems, its solution is going to be the optimal assignment. So it's a bijection. So it's also a very old algorithm, a very old problem, which is the optimal assignment problem that you can solve using typically these two algorithms, which are very efficient, the Hungarian algorithm and the auction algorithm of Bert Cekas, which have cubic complexity. And they are fairly easy to implement. So there's really like gems of combinatorial optimization. Okay. Then there is also a situation which is trivial, it's the 1D case. In 1D, optimal transport is called the monotonic arrangement. It means the optimal transport is just an increasing map between the two points, and there is a single increasing map. So it means you need to sort the blue point from left to right, the red point to left to right, and you're simply going to transport the first blue point to the first red point, and so on. So in 1D, optimal transport is n log n, and you probably don't need to attend to my talk and to use advanced softwares. Something that I will not cover is the fact that for the square of the Euclidean cost, then the optimal transport is basically related to a partial differential equation. Typically, in its static form, it's going to be the Monge-Ampère equation, and in its dynamical formulation, it's going to be the Benamou-Brogniet equation, which is a geodesic equation. And both can be solved using convex methods. And you're going to solve this by introducing typically finite elements and discretize the space. So in 2D and 3D, it's very efficient. Okay, but in higher dimension, when the cost is not this one, you typically cannot do it. Okay, so I will not speak about this, but there is a huge community in finite elements that are interested in solving this kind of tool. So, well, you should probably look at books and software on Monge-Ampère for this, and experts as, for instance, in Orsay, Quentin Mérigo, Jean-Marie Mirbeau, they developed a tool for this. Yann Brunier. So this is a geodesic between Yann Brunier, one of the founding fathers of optimal transport, and Jean-David Benamou, who is the Benamou here. And these guys have worked a lot on like software. Something that is closer to our field, I would say, and to computational methods that are very efficient, is once again in this special case of the square loss. But this time, when you want to transfer a discrete set of points to possibly a continuous non-cities. And in this case, it's fairly intuitive to convince yourself that optimal transport will basically be creating small cells and it's going to map each point to a cell. Rather the opposite, actually. You're going to segment the space in cells and you're going to map each cell to a single point. Going to crush an area of mass to a single point. And what you can actually show, and it's a very beautiful result, is that the cells are actually not like random cells. They are polyhedral cells, which are generalization of Voronoi cells. And this is used a lot because there is fast, efficient algorithm to compute Voronoi cells based basically on computing convex hull. And this gives very efficient algorithm in 2D, 3D, and maybe 4D. Because you can compute these cells efficiently, and then you can move the cells in a dynamical way. So we'll come back a bit later about this to show some codes, but this is probably the best method in low dimension, okay? If you want very accurate solution. And the last method I will insist on, and I will speak more about this this afternoon, so I will not describe the algorithm, is some idea where you would introduce some heat, some diffusion, to make the optimal transport simpler to compute. And it will not compute exactly the optimal transport, it will compute some epsilon approximation. So the price to pay is if you want accurate approximation, epsilon would be smaller and the algorithm would be very slow. So it's really a method that is good if you want crude approximation, especially if you are in high dimension, it's very important to have this kind of diffusion that would be more robust to high dimensional problems. So I will cover this afternoon. But really, they are like not competitors. They are like totally targeting different applications. This is to have accurate geometrical description, like for instance between like surfaces, and this is to have approximate optimal transports with very, very fast and very efficient, and especially things that are parallelizable. Because the main advantage of this tool is that it's computable on GPUs very efficiently, which I will cover later. It's the idea of now you need to switch to GPUs, and this algorithm is probably the only one that really is very easy to scale on GPU. And it's not so easy, and it's really related to the previous talk because it uses exactly the same tools of using kernels. And kernels are objects that you can really efficiently implement on GPU. So kernel, a Cochen kernel, is just interaction between a lot of points, and you can compute everything. It's a big matrix, and you can compute it very efficiently on GPU. So my take-home message is Syncorn is drawing a link between optimal transport and kernels method, which are like very old field with a lot of efficient methods you can apply. All right, so this is just like to give an overview of the different different alternative, and I will mostly cover this one and speak a bit about this. So before entering into the computational tools, I'd like to do some advertisement for this platform, Numerical Tools, which I maintain, which is absolutely not only on optimal transport. Optimal transport is maybe like 5% of the platform. It's much more general, and it's intended to present a lot of ideas at the interface between applied mathematics, signal processing, machine learning. Okay? And of course, the emphasis is on codes, but with really the idea that behind the code, there is some mathematics. Okay? So the goal is really to draw the links between mathematics and computational aspects. Okay? So this is just some samples, but I can show you the websites. So the website is numericaltools.com. Okay, so this is the home page. And initially it was implemented in MATLAB. And progressively it has been extended and converted to Python, Julia, and R. So MATLAB still has the biggest number of tools. So each tool is basically one page. But progressively the other one are picking up. And in particular, Python now is really strong. So the goal is to have everything in Python. But the most important part is in Python. So I will only cover Python today. So this is just the listings of the topics that are covered. So I will not speak about the different topics, but just to show you, there is a lot of stuff on signal and image processing. There is also a lot of stuff on optimization, like basically all basics methods on optimization, they are covered with example. There is related to this inverse problem, it is basically basically optimization together with image processing. There is a few stuff on shapes, so it's much more basic than what you have saw before, and these methods are intended to be like introduction to the field, not like state-of-the-art method. Computer graphics, a few, like shape, meshes, and so on. And what is interesting for us is this part, optimal transport, which here is basically four topics that I will explain. And to mention also for those that do courses on machine learning, basics method of machine learning are also covered. Basically, dimensionality reduction, unsupervised learning, supervised learning, and a bit of neural networks with PyTorch in it. So it's basic stuff, but intended to be used typically for courses, undergrad course, graduate course, as example to show to the students, as helper for small projects, for instance. There's many use you can make out of it. So let's take a few examples. So for instance, let's take the one on Syncorn entropic regularization. So I'm not going to explain it in detail. So the goal is not that you actually understand the code. It's just to explain how the pipeline goes It's fairly easy. It's just Jupyter Notebooks. Okay, so the four languages can be used inside Jupyter Notebooks. So the students or you just have to download the notebooks here. And then, here it doesn't download, but you can save it on your computer. And then you can edit the notebook locally on your computer. Okay, and you can run the code. So either each of the students has its own, I would say, Python 3 installation, which I have. So you just run the notebooks. It's going to be like this. I mean, I guess most of you already know what is a notebook, so I don't need to go into the details, but it's made of cells, text, and of course some code that you can execute. Okay? So you see all the mathematics is described, and usually you have interleaving of some mathematical equation and some code that you can run. Okay, it's going to be boring just to show you. So this is, you see, a very simple situation, illustrates the basics of optimal transports on a scenario where you want to transfer an annulus to some inside distribution of points, which looks simple, but it's not so trivial. How would you do it optimally and so on? It's a bit challenging. It's a small scale problem. So I will spare you the details, but you typically compute what is called a Gibbs kernel, which is this idea of connection between optimal transport and kernel's method. So K is the big thing here. It's going to be a big like Gaussian kernel. So it's what is costly implemented like this. And I will come back later to how do this efficiently. Here it's like very dumb, like n square full arrays. So the complexity is going to be n square, matrix multiplication. And you have an optimization algorithm that you run, and you monitor the decay of the energy. So here, epsilon, the approximation is really crude, so it goes very fast. Like in maybe 200 or 300 iterations, you can stop. It's very, very fast. And then you can display the result, which is this big coupling matrix. So we don't see much, but it's very dark, so mostly zeros with a few non-zero elements. And then you can play on the approximation epsilon to have better and better approximation. Sorry, you don't see almost anything. But at the end, if epsilon is very small, you almost get back the optimal transport. It's very slow, but you can get almost to arbitrary precision, close to optimal transport, which is a very, very sparse matrix. Okay? And this matrix describes the connection between the points, which you can draw like this. Okay? And if epsilon goes very, very small, you get very few connections. Typically, one point is connected to one or two points, which is more or less the case here. So you see, and the code is very easy. So just some comment on how actually this is done. Since I use it, and many people use it as exercise for students, actually the solution is hidden inside the file. But no worry, you can find the file online, and the student can also find the solution if he wants. The goal is not like to have like super complicated exercise. It's just that the student can at least spend some time on trying to find the actual implementation. And just to show you the actual code that is hidden, it's probably somewhere here, no? Yeah, so the solution, for instance, here. So there is one file per exercise. And it's going to be the implementation of the algorithm. It looks a bit complicated, but actually it's super simple because there's only like two important lines of code. All the other lines are just for display and to compute the errors you make. But the only two lines of the algorithm, well, are just these two lines, and I will explain this afternoon in more details. All right. And this is for points, but you can run the same algorithm now only with weights. So each point now has a weight, which is often called an histogram. So you can exactly run the same code, but now you can transport between two histograms. This is like very dumb example where you want to transfer two Gaussian. So it's a very almost trivial example, but just a sanity check. And you can run exactly the same code. So there's absolutely no modification. It runs the same and compute the optimal transport that is going to be map a point here to a point here. So here is when the Gaussian is very small, so it's not very relevant. But what happens here is typically a translation. Because when you transport one Gaussian to another one, you're just going to be translating the space. So it's, yeah, and then the student can play with it, can, of course, try on his own data sets. And it's fairly nice. Then what you can do is instead of computing transports, you can compute barycenter, where you don't only transport between two objects, but you can transport between several objects. Since I will run out of time, I will not go into the details, but the same code goes over. Something I'd like to mention is this also goes very nicely with a new platform of Google that maybe you know, which is called Google Colab. I'm a bit ashamed to do some advertisement for Google, but to be honest, it's super convenient. You just go to Google Colab if you have a Gmail account like this, And then you can simply create from scratch a new Jupyter notebook or import the numerical tour notebooks into Colabs. So you can run the same code exactly using Google Server. So now you don't need to install anything. It's very convenient. And it's exactly the same as before, but now it doesn't run on my computer. And what, of course, is super interesting is because now you can have access to the GPU of Google. So I guess if you go to here, parameter of the notebooks, you can select GPU and even TPU, which are supposed to be better GPUs, basically. So you just have one GPU. So they are generous, but not so much. But still, one GPU is more than enough for many things. Probably not training huge networks, but just for sync on, it's very convenient. And well, I'm running out of time. You see, I'm not cheating. It's really running live. OK, and the interesting part is at the end, just to show you, because at the end, it will run on the GPU. Because by default, it doesn't run on GPU. What you need to do is you need to send, of course, the data to the GPU, which is done here. And so it works. It has a GPU. Now you can compute everything on the GPU. Well, sorry, I need to run all the notebooks. But it works very nicely. And now the same algorithm as before is running on the GPU. And of course, it's much faster. And what is even more advantageous is not only you can run transport between two histograms, but you can compute transport between like virtually 1,000 and even millions of histograms at the same time, because they will all be hosted on the GPU and processed in parallel. So it's really the big advantage of this. And the Barry Center works the same. Let me come back to this, because I had a few more things to cover. So this is basically the one I showed you. There is the one that is simpler, as an introduction to optimal transport with the Samplex algorithm. You can start with this one. This is the one with SyncOn. There is another one which I called advanced topics, which cover like improvement over SyncOn, like how to stabilize it, how to make it more efficient. And this one is the one on semi-discrete optimal transport using this idea of Voronoi cells. So I will not present it, but there is also one on this computation of Voronoi cells. I would rather want to insist on more advanced library that you can use. Why do you want to have more efficient library? Because typically you don't really care about optimal transport. You use it to solve another problem, like shape registration, as was presented before, or even in machine learning to do modeling, to do training of generative networks, for instance. So what is the idea in all this field? Is you have some kind of generative process, some way to model your shapes, or here some way to model your data. And of course, what is very trendy is to use a deep network, what is called a deconvolutive network or generative networks, where you map a low-dimensional space state vector, like a latent space, to like an image, for instance, a high-definition image. And with this, you can generate a lot of points, basically an infinite number of points. And you want this point that you generate, something about a surface or a shape, to be as close as possible to the input data. It will be the pipeline, like everybody would be typically using this kind of pipeline for shape registration or for generative model training. And what is difficult now is you don't only want to compute the optimal transport distance, but you want to minimize the differences between your generative models and the input data. And then it becomes very painful. So what you would do is typically you would use automatic differentiation. This was mentioned a bit before. Just a few words, if you don't know, but probably everybody knows what it is. It's just a method, if you give me some codes, it computes the gradient of the cause directly. And the big thing is this theorem. And it doesn't use finite difference. Okay, just to be clear, finite difference is useless in high dimension because it's very expensive, because the complexity of finite difference scales with the dimension. So finite difference is plagued by the curse of dimensionality. It's just not the correct way to compute difference. So the correct way was proved by this guy in the 70s. Who introduced reverse mode automatic differentiation, which is called in deep learning backpropagation, but it's much more general than this. And it's actually a theorem, a very nice theorem, that says that computing the gradient has the same complexity as computing the function itself. And if this theorem were not true, nobody could use deep learning, nobody could do modern learning, because you need to compute gradient of a function, you don't know how to basically compute their derivative. So I think this is the key to have like to even make optimization possible on a lot of parameters. And this is what you're going to use for this optimal transport method, where you're going to implement optimal transport in PyTorch, for instance, using SyncOn algorithm or something else. And then you're going to ask to PyTorch to compute the differential. OK? Okay, so probably everybody knows about PyTorch or TensorFlow. As I've mentioned before, it goes very nicely with Google Colab, so you can run PyTorch in one line. You just install PyTorch, and then you can run everything. And my recommendation is, if you want to go to this level, don't try to code things by hand. Use library that people have done before, because even simple stuff as computing this, okay, it looks trivial, but just computing a Gaussian kernel divided by 2 sigma square. So we want to compute this kernel. It looks so simple. Everybody can code it in two lines. If you do this yourself on the GPU, it's a disaster, because it will compute all the pairwise differences and it will blow the memory. So unless you have a very small example that I've shown before, never compute this yourself on the GPU. Use a library that is dedicated to the computation of huge kernel that would avoid actually computing the kernel. It would compute on the fly the kernel, because otherwise it will just not scale on the GPU and you can only deal with very small example. And also managing the memory on the GPU is super complicated. Like, you want to access the memory in a very particular way, and if you want to do this, you cannot do this by PyTorch. You need to go through CUDA and so on, which I would never do, and most of you in the room would also want to avoid. And fortunately, people have done this for us. In particular, I'd like to thank these three guys, so Benjamin Charlier, Jean Fedi, and Johan Glohannes, who've done this amazing library, which is called KOps, which is dedicated to computing this kind of formula and even more complicated formula. And for this, they introduced a concept that is quite obvious, which is the idea of, if you have an expression like this, it's a mathematical expression, but it doesn't mean the computer wants to compute like this. It wants to keep this at what is called a lazy tensor structure, where the evaluation will be done only on the fly when required. Okay? And it's this idea of, instead of declaring your variable as you would do traditionally, you add the keyword lazy tensor, and then when you see, for instance, this formula, it will keep it in memory, but it will not evaluate the formula. It's only when you want to apply this to a vector, to do a reduction if you want, that it will do the computation on the fly. So it's like synthetic sugar, but it's super efficient, because you can code as you would do with PyTorch without the memory footprint. So it's a huge thing, and you can implement in a very nice way the same algorithm as before, the same code, simply adding this extra layer. And then you can compute transport between huge point cloud of hundreds of thousands of points. Of course, it would be slower because it's a huge data set, but it would perfectly fit into memory. And the improvement in terms of speed is also quite important. All right, so I think I've almost done. Let me also indicate to you, if you care about semi-discrete optimal transport, Bruno Levy, that maybe some of you know, who is a researcher at INRIA. Actually, now he's the boss of INRIA Nancy, so he's a big guy. And he's a great computer scientist who has done a very impressive library in C++ for geometric programming. In particular, he built this Geogram library, which has a part dedicated to optimal transport. So you can look at it. It's very different from this idea of PyTorch and so on. Here, it's really like hardcore C++, but it's the best implementation when it comes to this semi-discrete optimal transport. He has a lot of very nice video on YouTube if you want to look at. It's amazing. He uses this for a lot of applications, in particular in fluid dynamics, because you can use optimal transport to solve fluid dynamics, and also in astrophysics to have models of the creation of the stars. So he used it to map like billions of stars to understand the creation of the universe. So it's really like quite impressive, and they're trying to have like a large scale. So let me switch to the, I don't know if you see, but this is optimal transport between a very complex volumes and a sphere. So it's like, so this is this optimal transport. So you see how the armadillo gets mapped to the sphere. It's optimal transport between like volumetric meshes. And I will stop here because I'm out of time.
Thank you very much. Are there any questions?
Yep. The library also includes the case of unbalanced optimal transport.
Which library?
Some of them implement actually.
Yeah, actually, Syncorn is trivial to implement unbalanced optimal transport in Syncorn. It's just a multiplication, an additional multiplication. I don't think it's inside the numerical tools, but it's just one line of code. And I know that Jean attended to have like one tutorial on this for KOps, so probably we'll put it online. But really, using Syncorn, it's trivial. Using semi-discrete optimal transport is also possible, but I've never seen anyone having this. But I know Jean is using this for shape matching a lot, and they have a paper this summer about this for medical imaging applications. So just for the those that don't know the term, but unbalance refers to the case where the two masses are not exactly the same. You can have more mass on one side, and then you want to both do transportation and at the same time destroy some mass or create new mass. So it's basically it's a hybridization between Wasserstein and geometry of information. Because Wasserstein will be transporting the mass, and geometry of information, so relative entropy, would like destroy or create masses. And the advantage is synchron, it's really easy to do both at the same time. And I will speak about this afternoon, so stay tuned for for this.
So if not, let's thank Camille again.